of a new product. You might have a few stakeholders there, some customer representatives, some people representing the technology, maybe even marketing. And so a product owner might start out by explaining what the value is and what they're trying to accomplish in the marketplace. But then someone on the technical side kind of wants to dive deep into some of those implications. But before they can do that, the marketing guy's like, wait a second, how are we going to market this? And there's another stakeholder there from another part of the company goes, wait a second, how is this going to impact my part of the business? And pretty soon, what started as a fairly structured and organized conversation has sort of devolved into a model of inefficiency. Now, you may have this open conflict, you know, just two people butting heads. And that's painful and uncomfortable, but at least it's out in the open and you can deal with that. Sometimes you just have people talking past each other. They might, don't even sometimes think, seem like they're having the same conversation, or maybe they're even in violent agreement, but they just can't seem to connect. And you had this plan of what you wanted to accomplish by bringing all these people together, but you just can't seem to keep this group on track. And while this may be tempting to just sort of write this off as just another waste of your time, this time, you're going to do something a little different. So while all this chaos is going on, you just step up to the whiteboard and just start writing down what's happening. Start capturing the conversation. Don't have to do anything else. Just start writing down what people are saying. And soon some people start paying attention to what you're doing. And maybe someone asks a question or someone offers a correction or an add, and now more people are paying attention. Once you know the room seems to be having some pretty good agreement on this, well, now you start drawing. And it's nothing fancy, you know, just some like boxes and squiggles and just something that kind of starts to represent the conversation that was going on in the room. And now more people are paying attention. So in a very short period of time, you took this chaos, and you started to align people and bring people together so that by the time you're done, it actually feels like you got something accomplished. So what this is called is graphic facilitation. Now, if you're familiar with that term, what you might think about is maybe you've been to a big conference and there was a keynote and there was some person on the side with like a big 4x8 sheet of paper and they were like quickly drawing what this person was saying, and these were great artists and you're like, wow, that's really good drawings. Or maybe you've seen some people tweeting out like their sketch notes from a session and you're like, wow, they can really draw. We're not talking about that. All right, we're going to focus on two very simple things that all of you can do. And I know all of you can do this, because I've given this session lots of times, and I've never had someone not being able to do this. I've done this with lawyers. So if lawyers can do it, you can do it, all right? We're going to focus on note-taking and wireframing. And why I picked those two things is note-taking, if you're able to capture this publicly, it helps facilitate communication, so it brings everyone together, so we all have the same idea. And then wireframing, well, if we're trying to deliver value to someone, usually that means someone's going to have to do something to an interface somewhere. So we're usually having conversations about what that might look like. So, but you can apply this on multiple domains, you know, whether it's process flows, architectural diagrams. You can use the techniques we're going to do to solve a lot of different problems. But that's what we're going to be focusing on. And one of the nice things about this is you don't necessarily have to plan this out. Like, you can sort of apply this technique just sort of anywhere. Like, once you feel something going off the rails, you can say, hey, this is what we're just going to do. And you don't have to necessarily plan in advance. I do have some bonus content if we have some time at the end about how you can do some structured sketching. So, you know, if we're good on time, we'll get to that. So the three things that we're going to focus on that you need to be able to do this, and again, focusing on wireframing and note-taking, you got to understand some simple user experience basics, some basics around sketching, and then you have to be able to listen to what people are saying, quickly process that, and then enhance that with your output. Those are the three things we're going to work on today. So on the UX side, now obviously UX is a big and deep discipline, and I could spend days just talking about how awesome UX is and what we can do around that, but just to give us some context, you know, I just want to talk about four things. You know, goals, users, solution context, and then before you get to your solutions. So goals are really important. And I know that seems obvious, but having worked with a lot of teams, what seems obvious is not always happening. So, you know, not only do goals tell us like where we're heading and when we think we're done for now, but often how we define our goals defines which direction we're going to take. So it's really good before we start thinking about what our solution might be that we just align on what we're trying to accomplish. Who are we doing this for? There's lots of people that we could serve in the world, but we can't be everything to everyone. And in this case, if you have the research, awesome. If not, until you can get the research and really understand who your customers are, I would argue that consensus meets correctness. What I mean by that is if everyone has their own idea of who your customer is, one of you might be right, but everyone else is going to be pulling in a different direction, and then you don't have team alignment. So if you can all agree on a target, then at least you're pulling in the right direction, and you're probably close. And I don't mean consensus is not compromise. If you said, well, I think we should go after vanilla ice cream lovers, and someone else says, I think we should go after chocolate ice cream lovers, and you can't agree, you say, well, let's just target people who like strawberry, that satisfies nobody. But you can say, you know what, for the sake of this exercise, let's agree that we're going after chocolate, and then we can do the research later to figure out if that's the right direction or not. But if you don't have that alignment, you're just going to be wildly divergent as a team. So you got this idea, this need that people have that you're trying to satisfy. That need does not exist in a vacuum. It's part of a much bigger puzzle. You know, there's other things around it. It may be part of bigger goals. There's things that happen before and after it. You know, where does this need take place? How do people solve it now? And all of this just helps you to establish the context of what you're going to be sketching about. And again, that's where this applies to. You know, you may do slightly different activities if you're not talking about wireframes, but you just want to understand what is the context of this problem we're attempting to solve. And then you can start to visualize what that solution might look like. And when you're having these discussions, it helps to capture it publicly. If you just have a conversation, different people can like leave and think that they decided, you know, two people could walk away thinking that you decided something different. When you write it down, it becomes real. And if you take it notes on your own, you know, I mean, how many people like type out notes and then like email them out later? Yeah. How often are those the like among the thousands of emails that go unread? Right? It's great. It helps you clarify the thoughts if you're the person writing it down, but odds are people aren't going back after that meeting and go, let me just check and make sure that those notes came out exactly right. And even if they do go back and look, they might not really remember the conversation, whereas if you're up on the board and you're writing it down in real time, people can give you feedback. You can generate discussion based on that. When you're doing that, a couple quick tips. Use the words of the people who are speaking as much as possible, because it makes them feel heard. And if people feel heard, they're more engaged. Now, some people are, let's say, not as succinct as others, and it's a little hard to write what they would say. So in that case, you can, you know, if someone gives you feedback, you can say, let me see if I understand you. Is what you're trying to say this, and you can summarize. And then they have the opportunity to say, yeah, that's what I meant, or no, you got it wrong, here's what I meant. And then you can capture that. Check for agreement. When someone says something, is everyone on board or not? And ideally, you want to get actual, like, yes, I agree, or no, I don't. But sometimes that's uncomfortable. So at least you can look for body language. You know, people who are leaning forward and engaged, you know, they're there with you. Someone who's leaning back and they've got their arms crossed and they're looking off to the side, they might not be on board. And that's a good person to bring into the conversation. It's like, oh, so what do you think about what we're talking about? They might have a different opinion, but they don't yet feel comfortable sharing that, but it might be some really important content. Alternate colors when you're taking notes, and this is hard, and we're going to practice this a little bit, but it makes a huge difference, especially when you're in a big room. It's hard to kind of parse a lot of text, especially handwritten text. So when you alternate colors, it just makes it easier to see where like one point starts and the next one starts. And same thing, use all caps. I learned this from a building architect, because that's how they write. If you're looking at print, part of how we understand words is not just the letters, but the overall shape of the word. The problem with lowercase, and especially cursive, though, is when we're in a hurry, our cursive often just degrades to like a bunch of squiggles that we can barely understand. So writing in all caps slows you down a little bit and will tend to be neater so that everyone in the room will be able to understand what you put down. And lastly, if you're the one doing this, understand the power of the pen. If you're the facilitator, you have immense power and you can use it for good or for bad, and sometimes unintentionally. Like, if you made a point during a session, I go, wow, that's really interesting, and I write this down and go, okay, cool, you're like, yeah, my stuff was heard. Then I ask you for something and you give me feedback and go, that's really interesting, who else has a point? Now she's thinking, well, I just got completely ignored. I'm not gonna bother doing this again. And she's shut down. And if we wanna do the best work, we need everyone engaged. We can't afford to have people shutting us out and shutting down. Now, if maybe I don't agree, I can say, hey, that's really interesting. What do people think about that? And then we can have a discussion, and then we can capture whatever the result is of that discussion. So be aware that if you're the one writing, you have immense power. Now, sometimes you can diffuse that power by saying, oh, you have a point. Here, let me give you the marker. Can you go up and write what your idea was? Because then also you start engaging more people. All right, so that's all I want to say about like note-taking. Let's get to sketching. Now, some of you might be thinking, but I can't draw. As you see, I can't really either. Part of the problem is we think about sketching as art, right? I found this, I did not do this, by the way. I found this one online. And it is, quite frankly, it's a beautiful wireframe. I mean, look at this. There's like cross-hatching going on in here for shading. I mean, they really drew this in, like perfectly straight line. I'm assuming they used a ruler for that. It's a nice-looking wireframe. I want to show you my version of this. Before I do, let me point out a few things. So what do we got here? We got like a logo and the name of the company. We got like a navigation bar down here, like a header, some text. Couple images in there, sidebar with some stuff. All right, so keep that in mind. That's my version of it. And I'm guessing all of you can do something at least this shitty, right? But it's the same elements there, right? You know, in sketch language, a box with an X in it means image goes here, and I'm not gonna draw one, right? So you got like, there's the logo, and here's the name of the company, there's our navigation, you know, that's gonna be a header, there's our text, our images, and our sidebar. It's all still there, and I guarantee mine took a lot less time to do than theirs, and you still get it, right? If we're talking about what we wanted this page to do, you understand what the intent is, especially if I'm there explaining it, we're drawing it together. So you don't need to be artistic about it. This is meant to help communicate. All right. Get out of pointer mode here. Come on. You can do it. There we go. So. If you can draw a straight line, a squiggly line, a circle, and the alphabet, whatever alphabet that is, you have all the skills necessary to do what we're going to do today. All right? Let me break it down. What do we got here? Sorry? The web page, yeah. So, but you can, and you can tell that just from these like simple lines and boxes, right? Same thing, you know, up at the top, maybe that's the header, a little navigation bar and two blocks of content, and maybe that other one over there is like a text box with a button next to it. That's just squares. Y'all can draw squares. You know, again, like I said, sketch language, a box with an X in it means images go here. We add a couple images to this. Now, there's a couple ways we can look at for text. Sometimes we just want to show that there will be some text. So straight lines or squiggly lines is enough to say there's going to be some text here. I don't care what it is right now. I'm just showing you there's going to be some text here. Sometimes we might care about what kind of text it is, so we might kind of tag it. You know, that's a navigation bar, here's a header, here's a description. We'll tag it. Sometimes we want to be a little bit more directional because the type of content is a little bit more germane to the conversation we're having. Sometimes we want, take two. We might write in some specific content around that. And typically in sketching, we'll tend to combine all of those three techniques. There might be some areas where we just kind of put some lines in because we either know what that is or we don't care for this conversation. Some things we tag and some things we'll write some actual content. Okay, one more time, breaking it down. This was YouTube's homepage a while ago. Let's take a look at some of the components. Up at the top here, we've got the logo and one of those little hamburger menus. Big old search box, a couple buttons up there. Big ad, featured videos, secondary videos, lots more videos. So what does that look like as a sketch? All right, we got our logo up there, our little hamburger icon, search box, buttons, ad, featured video, secondary videos. Original sketch. Yeah, you guys with me? All right. Yeah, I want to check for agreement here. Yeah, you guys with me? All right, cool. One little tip before we actually get into sketching is a lot of people start by drawing a box. But we usually don't know beforehand how big our content's going to be as we're having this discussion. So if I was in this thing and I go, oh, hey, I'm gonna draw a box around this. So I go there, there's my box. And I go, oh, wait a second. I actually need three things on there. And then I add my third. Well, now I got my borders kind of going through there. It looks kind of ugly. So I often suggest if you need an anchor, just give yourself the corner. Since mostly in the Western world, we kind of do left to right, top to bottom. That tends to be how we think design-wise as well. So give yourself a corner if you need an anchor or not at all and box it at the end. And then when you're done, you go, oh yeah, we added my other box. And then I can just make my nice little square and then yay, there's my sketch. All right, last tip. Your turn. Had a lot of people standing over there. So if you guys either, there are some tables, if not, if you have like a notebook with you, then you can kind of draw while standing and follow along. That's cool because you'll all kind of work with each other over there. Before we get into this, I'm going to teach you guys a little game because we're going to get loud. I've done this a lot. We get loud. So I want to keep us on track so I can do as much with you as possible. So that means we got to kind of bring it down and refocus quickly. So who knows the game where I raise my hand and I say, can I have your attention, please? And when you see that, you raise your hand, you stop talking, and you look back at me. And if you see other people raising their hands, you stop talking, you raise your hand, and you look back at me, and we'll bring the whole room, we'll get quiet really fast. So I want to practice this real quick. So just start talking randomly. Just talk to the person next to you. Just babble out loud, gibberish, I don't really care. When I say, can I have your attention, please? All right, you guys are good at this game. Good, cool. All right, so there are bundles of markers on every table, or if you have a pen with you, that will be helpful if you're on the side there and using your notebook. Grab a sheet of paper or two and a marker. Prefer markers to like ballpoint pens because a nice fat marker keeps us from being too detailed, but if we're don't have enough markers, pen is fine. And what I'm going to do, just to keep it simple, kind of like what I did with the YouTube example, I'm going to put up a page, and I'm going to give you 1 minute to sketch that page. 1 minute is not a lot of time, so don't get too precious. You guys ready? Yes? Yes, okay, good. Here is here's your page. It's the old PayPal homepage. Let me get my timer going. But go ahead and start sketching while I do this. You get an extra few seconds while I get set up here. All right, 1 minute. Sketch this page. Images, quick, speed. About halfway done. What, halfway already? 5 seconds. All right, pencils down, as they say. Now, I just want you to show the people at your table or the people that you're standing near, I want you to show each other what you did. Because there's no wrong way of doing it, but you get to kind of just see how other people interpreted the same thing. So just show your table, take a minute, see what other people did. All right, can I have your attention? So that was fun, so let's do it again. You can flip the paper over, we're gonna save paper so you can use the other side. Yeah. So I mean, again, they're just two boxes. Like a text box might be longer, and a button might have something in it. So from a sketch perspective, they're just boxes. So links. So again, if you want to just do text that's underlined, or sometimes if I'm sketching on a whiteboard and I'm doing something, I might grab the second color. I might just, since links tend to be colored, and do that as a color. So there's different ways you can do that. All right, I'm going to give you your next page. This was CNN this morning. No comment on content, I just grabbed the morning screenshot. So take another minute, sketch this page. Actually, you guys are lucky because the old CNN screenshot was much more complicated. Would you believe that 30 seconds is gone already? See what other people did that was similar to what you did. Look for other examples where they represented something differently. think about what you liked about theirs that you might want to incorporate into your own sketching style. All right, can I have your attention, please? You guys are good at this. All right, so we live in much more than a web-based world, so let's do one more mobile. So if you might need another sheet of paper, if there's some space on the page you have, this will be our next drawing. So this is the Amazon front page for the Amazon app. 1 minute and go. This is usually like a relief after the complexity of CNN. It's like, oh, that was so simple. All right, can I have your attention, please? Now, for the next one, I'm not going to give you an example to look off of. I'm going to make it up. Who here has ever bought something online? Okay, who here just doesn't like raising their hands when they get asked questions? So I'm pretty sure all of you have bought something online before. Next, we're going to draw a shopping cart. And what I mean by that is when you go, hey, I like that thing, I think I might want one. And you hit the button that says add to cart, and then you see a page that shows the stuff that you want to buy. That's what we're going to draw. And I try to be really specific about this, because when I first started teaching this workshop, I would go around afterwards and collect pages, and I saw examples of the shopping cart on the right there. And the first time it happened, I thought, well, that was just quirky. And then when it happened a second time, I said, I'm not a good communicator. So trying to be very clear, we were talking about either a mobile page or a web page or something that has the stuff on it that shows what you want to buy. You've all seen one, probably multiples. So I'm going to give you 90 seconds this time to make up your own shopping cart. All right? I mean, there might be things like maybe there's a product image of the thing you want to buy or multiple things. Might have a price on it. Maybe there's a quantity and then a total. Sometimes there's ads, like other stuff you might like, or a place to put in a coupon code. Sometimes you can even put in like your location and check shipping costs before you proceed. You're done. Good. Pencil down. Yeah, you're done. Sorry, I don't have prizes. There's no prize for being first. Sorry, I apologize. All right, 15 seconds left. All right, now what I want you to do is walk someone else through your shopping cart. Explain your sketch to them. All right? It's okay to be in groups of three, too. Just take a minute and walk someone through your sketch. What do you got?
Items. If I want to see more, I click on this. I get another page. I see the more detail. Dollar quantities. I can put to my address. I can do a buy.
Good stuff. All right. Can I have your attention, please? So, what do you guys think? I got a mic here too. You've just drawn four different things. Is this on? You got the mic on? Anyone have any thoughts while we get the mic turned on here? What was this like?
What I felt was like, you know, you are giving us very limited time.
Yeah. So, do you think the time helped or hurt you?
It's actually helping. Yeah. Actually, it's hurting, but then it's actually helping.
So, start up.
You are trying to bring down our sketching standards.
Yeah, I am. I'm trying to bring down your standards. I love that. Yeah.
When you give 60 seconds, this is the best that I can do.
Yeah.
Anything is good.
Cool. Any other thoughts? Anyone else got a? There. So everyone else can hear you.
It works now.
No, go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, it's simplifying the things because we are short of time, right? And we have to convey maximum out of it. So we are not adding complexity. We are not adding too many fancy things, which are probably not required.
Cool.
MVP.
Hey, the difference between the first three and this one, you already gave us a visual representation of what we needed to do, so we just copied as is. This one, you just gave the idea, and we had to like think how we need to do it, and it's different from each person has something different.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, the functionality we want is there, but the UI is totally different for me.
And that's a really interesting thing, because when people have different ideas, sometimes the words won't bring out those different ideas. But then you draw it, and you go, oh, I thought, huh. Actually, I'll share a quick story. I was doing a workshop with the lawyers I mentioned earlier. And we were kind of kicking off this product that they wanted to build. And we got to sketching, and one of the lawyers is walking me through his sketch. And he goes, oh, and here's the calendar. And I was like, whoa, wait a second. We've been talking about this idea for 3 days, and you never once mentioned a calendar. So let's have a discussion about that. And I honestly don't know, because it didn't occur to me to ask at the time, if he'd always had that idea in his head and just somehow I didn't, as a facilitator, I did not elicit that idea, or if somehow the act of visualizing inspired him to say, ah, this fits here, and he came up with it on the spot. Doesn't matter. We added a story to, you know, our story map, and we had a discussion about why that was useful, and it was really helpful. Did someone over here have a comment?
This also helped us to consolidate all the ideas and to prioritize and put what best suits for a particular task, whatever you have given. So that felt very good.
Good. One more, maybe someone over here? Over here on the floor.
First three examples, you have already given the mind map already.
Yeah.
So we know what to draw. I mean, like whatever the visualization skills were, 0 or 100, I don't know, but something we wrote. Yeah, but the third example, like, you know, when you said 90 seconds, that's where it hit me. Okay, probably I need to do that mind map. It was tough for me.
It was tough?
Yeah, so.
What? Oh, okay, one more, you got me. We got time.
For me, it helped me to collaborate better and conflict management, because both of us was quite clear what we were talking and what was there, what was not there. So that collaboration without conflict.
Collaboration without conflict. Oh, I like that. So yeah, the structure of this is very intentional. I give you those, I tell you what to draw basically because I want to get you comfortable just with basic sketching language and not having to think. But obviously that's not the real world, right? You're going to be given ideas and have to work with it. So but now that you do a couple so you're familiar with sketching, a little more comfortable before I drop you into a less comfortable environment. And as it was already mentioned, we're emphasizing speed over quality. And it's not like you're going to go back to your team and someone's going to say, hey, let's sketch ideas. They're going to be like standing over you with a stopwatch going, go, right? That's not going to happen. But you do need to keep up with the ideas as they're coming out. When you're having these discussions, you know, people are going to be throwing stuff out fast and furious. So if you're still trying to be really particular with that first idea and someone else is on the third idea, you missed the second idea. So being able to do this rapidly helps you keep up with the conversation. This is about, again, about communication, not creating a deliverable. Put an asterisk on that, we'll come back to it though. One last little tip. Interfaces are typically built on a grid, and this will just help you be a little bit better with your sketching and how you kind of visualize things. So let's go back to that PayPal, and look at where does the grid fall in this page. You can start to see some rows, right? You know, there's a row there, navigation row, you know, this big row up here. And even if we look at this bottom area, this here, we can actually break that into multiple rows as well. There's sort of, oh, let me get the pencil. There's like the image row, the text row, the link row. So there's a couple rows, and then we go columns, and this is basically broken into thirds. You know, it's lined up off these, the thirds off this bottom one. But this image right here basically takes up two columns while this one takes up one. So once you start to be aware of grids, you can start looking at the other products you use and say, is this lined up on a grid? What does that grid look like? How can I use those types of things in the designs that I do? All right. So now the other bit of this. I said we kind of have to be able to listen to what people say, quickly process that, and then enhance it with our output. And I really, there must be like a word that better encapsulates that, though I haven't been able to come up with it. The closest that I get in terms of an activity, though, is improvisation. Do you guys have like improv theater, improv comedy? You guys know what that is? Good. So anyone not know what that is? Okay. Okay. So if you and I are part of here, you can stand up here with me. Don't worry, I won't make you do anything. If we were in an improv group, improv it just means that we don't know the script before we're gonna do something. So we might say something like, okay, we're gonna act out a scene, but we don't know what it is. So someone, you know, give me a profession, and people would just yell out professions. So yell out professions. What? Lawyer. So we got lawyer. How about a location? Give me a location. Mumbai. Maybe more specific. A park. So we got two lawyers in a park. They need to solve a problem. What's that? And with a banana. So two lawyers in a park with a banana. What's the problem that they're trying to solve? What's that? How to eat the banana. So we got two lawyers in a park trying to figure out how to eat a banana. Absolutely ridiculous. And obviously, we've never heard of this before. We haven't practiced this. And it takes a certain amount of skill to be able to then make it up on the spot. Thank you. That's it. We're not actually going to improv that scene, though it would be fun. And when most people think about doing improv, they go, ooh. They're probably even more afraid of that than sketching. But the good news is that all of you were awesome at improv when you're about this high, right? Because when you're a kid, everything is improv. Because your friend goes, hey, we're in space. You go, yeah, we're in space. And there's aliens over there coming to, all right, aliens over there coming to get us, right? That's all improv. And the good thing is, it's kind of like a muscle. It can atrophy, but you can build it back up again. You can strengthen it. So we're going to practice that just to, so you can prove to yourself that you can do this too. So I want you to pair up. So you know, you don't have to be at a table. Just find a pair, someone to pair up with. If you do not have someone to pair up with, raise your hand. If you're raising your hand, look for someone else raising their hand. So we'll make this work. So find a pair. I see no hands, so does everyone have someone to do this with? I got one hand over here. I got one over here, so why don't you guys connect over there? Anyone, everyone else have someone to work with? All right, so here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna plan a party. And you're gonna work together to plan a party. One of you is gonna start. And the way you're gonna start is you're gonna say, I need to plan a type of party for a person, such as I wanna plan a birthday party for my wife, or I wanna plan a wedding for my son, whatever. Pick a type of party and who you're gonna plan it for. And you're gonna set the stage by making that statement. Now, every statement that follows has to start with the words, yes, but, for each person. So I might say, if I'm one person, I say, okay, I want to plan a birthday party for my daughter. And it goes, yes, but I don't know what your daughter likes. Yes, but we can ask her. Okay, yes, but didn't you want it to be a surprise? So, like, you just go back and forth. Every statement starts with yes, but. So I'll give you a few minutes to have this conversation and plan your party. All right, go ahead. What? Oh, the statement slide. Yeah, there we go. All right, now I want you to switch roles so the other person gets to start and set the context. But this time, instead of yes, but, we're going to do yes, and. All right? So go ahead. Start and plan a new party. Other person starts. Same opening statement, but this time it's yes, and. And please go.
And you know, it's getting dissolved.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's getting diminished by yes, saying yes, but.
Yes, but, yes,
yes.
Okay. And in the second way, okay, so we started constructing and getting more ideas.
Yeah.
To the what we thought.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm thinking of.
Great. Any other thoughts?
It was hard to express things that you wanted to say no to when your statement started with yes.
Interesting. So even when the but was there, it was hard to say no. Interesting. Here, pass the mic back so everyone can hear.
The conversation when we had with the first scenario with the yes and but, we never came to a kind of a conclusion or any, you know, it just every statement we were hesitating to talk. But then when we had the essence and there was a very constructive discussion going on and we were able to come to a conclusion.
Great. The party was planned. Anyone more over here?
With the first one, yes, but it seemed, although it started with yes, it seemed quite negative approach to giving some feedback or adding on to the conversation. But with yes and, it was like, okay, there's something more I can give to you. There's something more I can add on to what you want to do.
Great, thank you. So sometimes the takeaway from this is that and is good, but is bad. That's not necessarily the case. And opens a conversation, and but constricts it. And there are sometimes in the product development process where we want to open up to new ideas, but there's sometimes we want to winnow down ideas. And so that there is an appropriate time for each technique. So sometimes we want, again, one more. Sometimes we want to focus and find reasons not to do something. We're going to do one more. Just to, you know, I like to have a meaning to these games, you know, the idea is to practice improv, but we're going to do them, let's do ones that have like a business application. For this next one, you're going to work as teams in your tables. I might split you guys into two groups over there, and maybe you guys that are sitting can come up here. What you're going to do is you're going to tell a story. As a team, as a table, one word at a time. So if I was at this table, and I might go first, I might say once, upon, a, time, there lived a man. Okay, so now we're telling a story about a man. And then it continues around the table, one word at a time. So don't do once upon a time, there lived a man. No, that's two. Your word is a, if that's the one you choose to do. You also don't have to create the world's longest run-on sentence. So you can end it, and sometimes you can end with tonality, like, there lived a man. When you bring things down, it tends to indicate that's the end of that sentence. Doesn't stop the next person from picking it up again, but you know, that's one way to end it. Or if you feel like the last person did such a good job of ending that sentence, you can just say, period, and that's your word, and you can sort of end that sentence, period. And the next person can start a new sentence, not a new story, a new sentence that continues that story. So you're going to work together as a team to tell a story. So again, I'll give you a few minutes. You know, for those of you in the tables, you guys might want to join a table here or here. Why don't we split you guys up in half, and half of you can kind of tell a story there, half of you in the back. And for you guys over here, you can kind of come up here just so you can kind of be near each other. One other thing I will ask of you is, again, it's going to get loud. If you want your team to be able to work with you, they need to be able to hear you. So you need to be able to speak up, all right? If it helps to stand, some people find it helps to stand. That's fine. That's up to you. So go ahead, start telling your stories as a team. If you go completely off the rails, just start again. All right, can I have your attention, please? Let's bring these stories to a close. Can I have your attention, please? You guys can, during the break, feel free to do this all you want. Thoughts about this exercise?
It's tough.
It's tough. What was tough about it?
When the story started, I kind of framed some words in my mind thinking they're going to take it up.
Yeah.
But how the words flew, those words didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
And I had to think of new word to maybe, again, give it a start because not everybody was thinking in that sense to give it a start or a story. We're just thinking of words to make it together, a sentence.
And that's never happened in like a meeting where you're talking about something. You have an idea where you think that conversation's going, and then it goes somewhere else, and you kind of have something else in your mind. And now you're behind because you weren't really paying attention, right? We all do this, right? Not just so people can hear you.
Also, it's like what we learned in the morning from the trainer. It's messing the mind. It's like everybody has a new word. You'll have to think. You'll have to be creative and unique. And it's nice.
You have to be creative and unique, okay?
So in a way, we had to pay attention to where the story was going so that we could think the right thing fast so that we continue.
You have to be really mindful, really pay attention to what's going on.
It was very spontaneous as well.
Spontaneous. Back here.
Creates good energy after lunch.
Good energy after lunch. Awesome. I told you we're not napping in this one. One more over here. I just really like running across the room, apparently.
So when there are too many people adding to a conversation, it goes nowhere. And everyone seems to be going in a totally tangential direction, and it doesn't lead us anywhere.
So how did you find the interaction amongst your team? Did you end up gelling together the store, or was it just going off in different directions?
Well, we were, but then, you know, we start off, and then it goes in some other direction, and then we try to use various buts and howevers and try to, you know, get them back to track. But everyone is just thinking so differently, right? So it is hard to converge.
Hard to converge. So, but it helped bring that difference to the surface, right? Now you're at least aware of what those differences are. One last comment?
With respect to what she mentioned, I mean, I had some difference of opinion there, but what I felt was it is sometimes good to be in the flow.
Good to be in the flow.
Sometimes it is not what I thought of, but it is sometimes good to be in the flow in which everybody else is thinking.
Yeah. And we all have different parts to play in this story, right? Sometimes we get to add a pivotal concept. Like, once upon a time, there was a... That next word is going to set the direction of this story. But sometimes our word is something like or the. And it's not as exciting, but it's still an important role. The story doesn't exist without those connecting words. So sometimes our role in telling the story can be a pivotal role, and sometimes it's a supporting role. So anyway, I like these games because they have a sort of a lesson to them. But again, what I wanted to do is really demonstrate that you have this capability to think on your feet, to think creatively, to kind of get out of your normal patterns, and that will help you with any kind of facilitation, sketching or not, that you do. You can do this. So for me, these are like mental calisthenics. I'm not suggesting you do these games with your team, though, hey, they're fun. Knock yourself out. But again, it just helps you redevelop your improvisation skills. So let's just recap briefly. We talked a little about some UX basics. We did a little bit of sketching. Did a little bit of improv. So now we just want to kind of put that all together. How are we doing on time? Doing good on time. Awesome. So the last sketch I had you do was a shopping cart. So we're just going to finish the checkout process. And there's typically two more things you need to finish a checkout process. You need to give the person you're buying from, the entity you're buying from, money, because otherwise they might be reluctant to give you whatever it is you want. And then you have to tell them where to send it. So usually we have a shipping page and we have a billing page. Now the way we're going to do this is we're going to pair off again. And one person is sort of going to play the product role. And if you're playing the product role, it's your job to tell the other person, here's what I think we need at this step in the process. Now if you're the other person, it'll be the sketch noter. So when that person is telling you what they need, I want you writing it out. And I want you writing it out so that they can see it, and that they can give you feedback to make sure you're getting it right. Remember the tips I gave you before. Use their words. Alternate colors. Especially if you're taking turns, you can grab the other person's marker. Now you have two colors. Alternate colors. Try writing in all caps. Once you've discussed the idea for a little bit, then I want you to switch to sketching. So if you were taking notes, then I want you to drive the sketching and start sketching out something that represents what you were drawing. And if you're the product person, give them real-time feedback. Yeah, that looks good, or not so sure about that, or what if we did it this way? Give them feedback. Now, in a real-world situation, we'd probably be doing it on a whiteboard. We can erase and redraw. We don't have enough whiteboards. Just got one. So we're going to do it with the markers, but feel free to cross out, start again. You know, it's more to have the experience. It's easier when you have a conference room with a whiteboard. So I'm going to give you about 3 to 4 minutes to do each page. So do the first one. Let's say we'll do shipping first. Pair up. One of you is the sketcher. One of you is the product person. I'll tell you when we're about halfway done, because that'll be a good time to sort of switch from note-taking to sketching. And then we'll do a second round for the payments page. And that way you can switch roles, so each person gets to experience both sides of it. All right? Any questions before we start? In the back. Sorry? Yeah, let's do the, we can do the shipping page first for 4 minutes, and then we'll switch roles and do the payments page. Okay? Any other questions before we start? No? All right. Off you go. All right. So that's the end, we'll end round one. I know some of you are probably a little frustrated because you didn't get to capture as much as you would have liked or sketch the full thing out. That's okay. We're just here to have the experience. We're not here to actually build a product. So you'll have plenty of opportunities with your own teams and your own products to do lots of this stuff. So now I want you to switch roles and do the other page. So I said we did shipping. Oh, you did both. All right. Well, you can do more sketching then. You guys are ahead of the curve. So switch roles. So that if you are the sketcher, now play the product role. If you're the product person, play the sketcher. Spend the first part with notes and then start sketching. I'll let you know when you're about halfway through. Attention, please. Great. Now, what I want you to do, I want everyone to take out their phone. What does that say? You have a question. Okay, yeah, hold on. Hold. I know your question. Hold on. There'll be questions at the end, and yours is a good one. I want everyone to take out their phone. All right? Launch your camera and take a picture of it. Remember when I said at the beginning that we're doing communication but not a deliverable? Well, there's kind of can be an exception to that. Because in many cases, what I've found, especially when we're working with a great cross-disciplinary team, this may be as far as we need to go as far as deliverables go. You can take the sketch and start building off that, start designing off that. You may not need any more documentation than that, especially if the right people are in the room. So if you do a sketch, let's say, and you already have a visual style guide and everyone agrees that that's what you're going to build, great, we know what it's going to look like, we'll apply our styles, we can start building it. Or maybe a designer's going to take it, I don't need to do a formal wireframe, the designer can take my sketch and start working with it, and developers can start building the back end. So sometimes that picture is really all we need. Sometimes we don't even need a picture if we have like a war room that's all whiteboard, sometimes we'll just leave the sketches up and that'll be what we go off of until we don't need them anymore, then we erase them and sketch more. So sometimes just having that picture is all you need. Now we've had a lot of practice, but I'm imagining some of you still might not be comfortable doing this in front of your team. Am I right? Yeah? Still feels maybe a little nervous to go back and do this? That's okay. I want to talk about something called progressive desensitization. It's a big word, but really all it means is let's get close to the thing that scares us a little bit at a time. And the airline industry used to be really great at this. I think they've cut a lot of the programs. But for people who are afraid of flying, they could enroll in this project, and the first thing they would do is drive by an airport. That's it. Drive by an airport. You're getting close, not that close, but close to the thing that scares you, flying. And then when you're used to driving by the airport, you might go into the ticketing area. You're a little closer. That might be nervous for you, hard, but just do that until you're comfortable with that. Then they take them to the gate, and they could see a plane. And that could be pretty frightening. But you know you're not going to get on it, so that's okay. And they would do that until the person gets comfortable. And then they get on a plane, but they knew it wasn't one that was going to take off. But they would just get used to getting on the plane. And eventually, they would fly. And obviously, this is in the airline's best interest, because if you have a fear of flying, they get no money from you. So helping you get over that is good for them. But this is an example of progressive desensitization. So while we're in this sort of magic realm of conference land, this is cool, we're all doing this together. But it can feel a little hard when we get back into our own teams. And I don't want you to lose this. So if you don't feel comfortable just jumping in, I want you to think about how could I step into this experience. Maybe you do start by just taking notes yourself, just to see if you can keep up with the conversation. It's more about yourself than the team initially. And then maybe you walk up to the whiteboard during a conversation and you start taking notes publicly, but you're not really facilitating. You're just kind of capturing what's going on. And eventually, once you do that, the facilitation will naturally happen. Same on the sketching side. You might start just doing some drawings yourself. Maybe you'll share them later, but it's just, how can I do this in this environment, responding to the conversation I hear, before you get up and start doing it in front of people? So just think about what's a small step that I can take to take what I've done today and move it forward in my own practice. One other approach you can use, and that's faking it. As an example, what I want you to do is I want everyone to put your legs together. If you're standing or you're sitting, if you're cross-legged on the floor, it might be a little tough, but put your legs together, cross your arms, hunch your shoulders, put your head down, and just get really small, all right? Just make yourself small. And in a very soft voice, I want everyone to say, "I'm a rock star." Yeah, okay. Now stand up, everyone stand up. And I want you to do your best, either like victory pose or like hero, superhero pose, either one. And I want you to say, "I'm incompetent." You can sit down. See, it doesn't work. Our mind and body want to be in sync. And we can use that to our advantage. This comes from research Amy Cuddy did, C-U-D-D-Y. She had a great TED talk on power poses. And there's been research that shows that 2 minutes in a power pose actually changes your brain chemistry. How cool is that? So what you can do with that is, even if you feel nervous, even if you're not sure that this will work, you can put on a positive stance, you can walk with confidence up to the room, and in your own mind you can think, "Today I am going to take responsibility for my team getting something done," and you do it. And after a while, you won't even realize you're still faking it. All right. Any questions? I know there's a question. You had a question over there. All right, the question was, how do you do it in a distributed environment? I hate this question, but I get it all the time. It's really hard, but sketching is actually easier. If we have time, I will talk about Design Studio, which I have as one of the few things that is very collaborative, which I have found I can successfully do with remote people. One thing that I find works well is either document cameras or other virtual meetings so that you can see what the other person is drawing. But anytime you're doing something this interactive remotely, it requires an extra level of effort on the whoever's facilitating to make sure that everyone gets heard, especially if most of the team is in one location and you have like one or two outliers who are remote. Then it's on the responsibility of those people who are in the same location to make sure that they're including those outliers with document cameras and other things. Like document cameras, just like it's like a stand with a camera on the top that just looks down. And so that way someone can draw and other people can see what they're doing. But I find that that is better than the digital drawing tools, because you know, using a mouse and other thing is just, it's not fast. So it's too hard. Any other questions? How am I doing on time?
Are outside, basically, which is in my case, where the team is sitting at one position, place, all yeah. 40 people at one place, product owner is sitting at another place. I'm really not able to do any kind of sketching.
So let me see if I understand.
I have to ensure that I have everything ready beforehand, and that really I believe in a bit.
So you say your product owner is in one place,
yeah,
you're the product owner, and your team is somewhere else. Yeah. So I would encourage you to look for a way to incorporate it, for the simple reason is that the more your development team feels bought in on the solution, especially because they help create it, the more they're going to be enthusiastic about building it. And I would also say that, you know, I'm a UX guy. I have a pretty high opinion of the design deliverables that I do, but good ideas can come from anywhere. And while it is normal for me to assume that something is easy when it's actually hard, occasionally I will not put forth a design because I think it's going to be hard, and then my developer goes, "Ah, there's a framework for that. We just dropped." I'm like, "Really? Oh, I didn't even think about that." So the more that I involve my team about what I'm trying to accomplish, for whom and why, and bring them into these activities, the better the solutions are at the end. It doesn't matter where the ideas come from, just that we find the best ideas. So I just encourage you to, even if it's not the easiest, to just try it and see what happens. And it might not work the first time. Don't be discouraged. Try it again. Any other Any other questions? What do we have till 3:15? 3:15. All right. Well, if there's no other questions, I do have we do have some super special bonus achievement unlock content. And it's only be a few minutes, but it sometimes comes up like, yeah, you can do this without planning, right? You're having this discussion, it's not going anywhere, like, hey, let's take some notes publicly and let's start sketching. It does help bring a team together. But sometimes you know you have a problem that you need to solve and you want to kind of bring multiple brains in on it, especially multidisciplinary brains. And so there's a technique called Design Studio, which is the worst name ever, because try Googling Design Studio. You get everything, because every creative group or advertising agency calls themselves a design studio. If you do add the word sketching to it, like design studio sketching, you'll find more info. Okay, that's my rant on that. Anyway, design studio, basically how it works, you identify a focus area, you sketch individually all together for about 8 minutes, you share with each other, and you rinse and repeat. There's a couple variations, but this is the general recipe. Now, I've seen some really like cool templates out there that you can download. Here's like six, you know, little squares, and you can see this little menu bar at the top. And that's fine. But when I teach techniques, I like to be able to do things with whatever materials I tend to have in front of me. I also find that six can be a lot. Four seems to be plenty. And four is really convenient because I can take a piece of paper and fold it in half one way and fold it in half the other way, and I got four squares. And we probably can just run to the printer, grab a stack of paper, and run back to the conference room. But I find four up is pretty good, because the first idea is kind of obvious. The second idea, you're probably cheating, and it's a variation on the first idea. The third idea, now you got to start thinking about something different. And the fourth idea, wow, you really got to kind of go off, you know, really out of that proverbial box. So I find that four ideas in 8 minutes is pretty good. So again, in an 8-minute session, we know what we're trying to accomplish. Each person sketches four different ideas. And then we post them on the wall, and we give positive feedback only. Now, why positive feedback only? One, most of us are not skilled in either giving or receiving critique. And if you give someone negative critique, and it inadvertently comes off as maybe a little personal, or maybe they just take it personally, again, they're shutting down. That's not helpful. We want people open so we get the best ideas out. And what I've found is that when you give someone positive reinforcing feedback, the things that you comment on will tend to live on to future rounds. And things that don't get commented on tend to die on their own. So it's not really necessary to do as much of the negative feedback. So we do one round of four ideas, we get our positive feedback, and then we do it again. And we can do the same four ideas we did before. We can do two of our original ideas and steal two ideas from other people. We can do four completely new ideas, just four more ideas based on the discussion, the feedback we just had amongst ourselves. And again, then we put those up, collect positive feedback only. For the third and fourth rounds, we do a single idea on the whole sheet of paper for the 8 minutes. And this gives us a little bit more of an opportunity to pick what we think is the best idea and go deep on it. Sometimes you don't even need a fourth round. I've certainly gotten to the point where it feels like a team is coalescing on an idea, you know, at the end of that third round, and we decide to kind of cut it off there. But if there's still lots of ideas out there, a fourth round can be very helpful. And then you can repeat this exercise for some key areas of your idea, of your product idea. Now, why is this useful? One, you gather lots of ideas. If you only have five people doing this exercise, that's 20 ideas that you start with on the first round. It shortcuts the feedback loop dramatically. I mean, think about the old way of doing it. If I'm the designer and you guys are giving me some feedback, I'll talk to you for a while. I will then go off into my space. I will design something awesome, and then I'll bring it back to you, and you'll give me all the negative feedback on. I'll go, oh, okay, I didn't think about those things. And then I go back into my space, I do something else, and I come back. And we do these rounds, and it takes a while. We can get these four rounds of feedback within like an hour. So what might have taken almost a week before, we get done in about an hour. So really shortcuts the feedback loop. Everyone's involved. When you get everyone sketching, people are bought in. So especially if you have developers sketching, if you have stakeholders sketching, they're part of the idea, and that means they have greater buy-in because they were part of the process that created it. What's also I've found is really interesting is that you know, some, like I said, sometimes we can use the one of our sketches as the guide. We don't have to go any farther. But if it's something where design is then going to take that input and then create a set of wireframes, one, your designer UX people have tons of ideas to work with. And whatever they come back with is going to be familiar to the team, so it's more likely to get buy-in. And again, I've seen people all up the chain do this. They might be a little skeptical. I remember one workshop where I had a C-level guy in the workshop, and he didn't know he was going to be sketching. And so I introduced the exercise, we start doing it, and I see him look to his right and look to his left like, are we really doing this? Well, everyone else is grabbing paper. I guess I'm sketching too. And at the end of the workshop, he was on his way out, and he stopped and said, you know, I was a little skeptical about that sketching thing, but that really worked out well. It has a great way of unblocking people, and again, just bringing your team together. So you get to this pretty good result, and you do it together. So that's all I have. I can take any more questions people have. One favor I will ask is that if people could bring the markers and the pages up to the front on your way out so that it makes it a faster cleanup for the next person. And lastly, if you want these slides, if you send an email to msm@zip.sh with the subject line Agile India 2017, you'll get an email back with instructions on how to download the slides. So again, I'm open for any questions, and thank you very much.
This is really great. I was kind of shy about doing this stuff too, but I can see the value in it. I'm thinking that these exercises might be really good in helping the team get to know each other and become more productive. There's so much value, I think, in just learning, like spending time with each other and doing things like this and having fun at the same time. Do you agree? I mean, does that sound right to you?
Oh, absolutely. I think it, and I think because of the nature of sketching, we can make it multidisciplinary. So it can break down those walls between like, oh, on the design side and on the engineer side and the product side. You know, it reinforces that we're all in this together. Like this product succeeds based on all of us, not just on the work of one of those teams. Why am I talking to the mic? I have a mic here. So absolutely, and even we were having a discussion earlier. She was asking about the improv exercises. What's the business value of those? And she had the great idea of doing an icebreaker with those. Because you guys laughed a lot. And that happens all the time. They're fun. You can bring a business meeting into it, and if you're bringing a diverse group of people in it, you need that icebreaker. At least do an icebreaker that has relevance to what you're doing. So the improv exercises can be good for that too.
What about if you have your team, do you have to sort of give them a quick run through of how to sketch first? Or?
Sure. So the question was, if I have a team, do I give them a quick run through of how to sketch? I will do sort of an abbreviated version of what I did before in terms of like, hey, here's a page and here's what it looks like is in a sketch. Look, here's a box with an X through it. And I will draw like just a simple wireframe just to give people an example to kind of set their expectations, level set them, and then we just kind of dive into it. Right, so they don't have that expectation like I have to produce art, right? Anyone?
It's actually fun. Thank you. And I'm just trying to see if you can point us to some resources where we can find out more such activities and stuff like that.
Which type, like sketching activities? So for the sketching, if you like do Google searches on either on sketching or graphic facilitation, there's other books and other stuff out there. Game storming? There is a book of like improv exercises that have like business value. I think it's called Game Storming. But I might be wrong on that. If you tweet me or something, email me, I'll look up the book I'm trying to think about. Anyone else? All right. Again, thank you so much for coming.